What's up, ninjas? Sensei Silver's here at X-Fiz Ninja, and I've got a joke to get things started off. A Danish politician, a Venezuelan runner, and a bull all walk into an X-Fiz lecture. Tune in to episode 1 of Neuromuscular Fizz to find out the punchline. Well, maybe it's not so much of a punchline, but find out why they're all connected together. And we'll talk about some other muscle stuff too. Okay, welcome to episode 1. In this video, I'll cover some of the basics of skeletal muscle structure, including some of its unique properties, hierarchical structures, connective tissues, and architecture. Let's begin by covering some basics about skeletal muscle. First, the focus of neuromuscular phys will actually be skeletal muscle. There are indeed other muscle types, notably cardiac muscle tissue and smooth muscle tissue. But we're going to focus on the skeletal muscle for this particular learning mission. Now, skeletal muscle performs what many could see as 4 broad functions. The first is that skeletal muscle is attached to bones, so that allows us to move. Second, and related to that, is that skeletal muscles allow us to maintain a certain posture or body position, and more specifically, we can sense that body position. Third, since muscles tend to wrap around joints, they inherently provide some added stability to those joints, much like ligaments would. And fourth, skeletal muscle is very metabolically active, meaning that it can produce or generate heat. Now, that added feature allows us to help preserve the functions of a variety of vital organs within the body. Notice how long the skeletal muscle fibers are. That long cylindrical shape of skeletal muscle fibers is very different than what we see from other cells in the body. You may picture a spherical type of cell whenever you hear the word of cell. Well, skeletal muscle fibers are indeed cells. They're skeletal muscle cells, and they're round from a cross-sectional perspective, but they're really rather long. It's more of a cylinder. And because of that added size and length, skeletal muscles also have multiple nuclei, and you can see those by the dots throughout the image that's on screen. Now, the added benefit of multiple nuclei is that you're able to speed up the operations that occur within the cell. Think of it like this. If you had one nuclei directing everything that happened in the cell, and it's a rather large cell, understandably, it's just going to take some time for things to happen. But if you were to have multiple nuclei sharing the load throughout that cell, you can dramatically speed up the order of operations. And don't let me forget, skeletal muscle cells are part of what we would call the somatic nervous system, meaning that they are under voluntary control. If I want to contract my biceps, I literally think, contract, and it contracts. All right, so skeletal muscle has 4 basic properties. The first is contractility, which basically means that the contractile filaments, actin and myosin, can stick together and form tension or force so that you can lift heavy weights. The second is irritability, or sometimes known as excitability. Now, that doesn't mean that a muscle is moody. It basically means that if you present an electrical current to a muscle, it will turn on. Typically, that electrical current, it comes in the form of an action potential that we generate within our body. However, if you've got one of these, this is a TENS unit. This is a battery with some electrodes, and I can put this on my muscle and it'll turn on. Check it out. Moving on, third property of muscles is extensibility, which basically means that you can elongate it. I like to picture saltwater taffy being stretched and pulled apart, and as you pull that apart, it begins to droop down because it becomes so thin. Now, extensibility by itself wouldn't be very helpful for a muscle because we want it to be able to return to its resting length, and that is our fourth property. call that elasticity. So that basically means that if you elongate a muscle, it's going to snap back to its resting position, much like a rubber band. All right, now that we've discussed skeletal muscle basics, let's talk a little bit about structure. Now, the way a skeletal muscle is organized is it's very hierarchical. And starting from smallest to largest, we see myofilaments. Now, I'll talk more about myofilaments here in just a moment. But if you were to bundle up a bunch of myofilaments, you end up with something known as a myofibril. Now, if you bundle up a bunch of myofibrils, you'll have what's known as a muscle fiber. So this is what a lot of people think about when they're considering how a muscle is structured, but it's really not the smallest level. It does have some distinct properties, which we'll get into later on as well. If you bundle up a bunch of muscle fibers, you have what's known as a fascicle. And if you were to bundle up a bunch of fascicles, you now have the whole muscle. Now, woven between a lot of these is various connective tissues, which I'll also speak about here in just a moment as well. Now that I've covered the hierarchy of muscle structure, I'd like to dive more specifically into the myofilament level, the myofibril level, and the muscle fiber level. I don't know if there's as much specifically to speak to with fascicles or the whole muscle level, but there definitely is at those three smaller levels. Check it out. Let's talk a little more specifically about myofilaments. Remember, that's the smallest level. And within skeletal muscle, there's two main players. There's actin and there's myosin. Now, these are often considered to be the primary contractile filaments because they're the two things that stick together and give rise to that basic skeletal muscle property of contractility. Actin is often referred to as the thin filament, whereas myosin is often referred to as the thick filament. Now, what you can see in your ninja slides is that actin, the thin filament, doesn't really exist by itself. Rather, there's two other key structures that are bound or wrapped around it, and those are troponin and tropomyosin. We'll talk more about their roles a little bit later on when we get into skeletal muscle contraction. But just know that collectively, as a unit, actin, troponin, tropomyosin, they work to help regulate the skeletal muscle contraction that we see within a whole muscle. Myosin, as you can see, is noticeably thicker than actin. And interestingly, you've got these heads that kind of jut off in all directions. And it's worth mentioning that because of that 360-degree arrangement, every myosin head has the potential to be able to connect with six, count it, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 actin filaments. Now, that may not seem like a very important point, but it's actually a huge point as it relates to our ability to be able to generate a lot of tension at microscopic levels. Now, actin and myosin often get all the glory when it comes to skeletal muscle, but there are other major players at the myofilament level. Some that I have chosen to include here would be collagen, elastin, nebulin, and titin. Now, collagen and elastin, you're going to see those in a variety of areas throughout the body. Collagen is primarily a structural type of protein. It's very rigid. It does have some elasticity, but it's primarily rigid, and that's what gives rise to a lot of the strength that we may see in various structures throughout the body. Within a skeletal muscle, it's found in abundance, primarily in the connective tissues like paramecium and endomecium. They'll ultimately weave together to form the tendons that would connect a whole muscle to a bone. In fact, there is so much collagen within a skeletal muscle that it can account for up to 10% of the dry weight of an individual skeletal muscle. So collagen plays an important structural role. Elastin, as the name implies, is very elastic or stretchy in its manner. A basic property of skeletal muscles is that they're elastic. You can stretch them out. They're going to return back to normal. So it would make sense that there should be a lot of elastin within a skeletal muscle. You find a lot of the elastin in the connective tissues like collagen. Okay, so at the myofibril level, we have a certain arrangement of myofilaments that gives rise to what we call the sarcomere. That's the basic functional unit of shortening within a muscle. Before I talk about some of the identifiable features of the myofibril, I just want to point out some of those notable myofilaments that we just discussed. Actin, you can see here, is illustrated in blue. Myosin in pink. And noticeably, the actin is much thinner than those myosin filaments. It's also worth mentioning that we've got titin illustrated in purple here. Remember that titin helps keep the myosin anchored within the sarcomere. And nebulin does the same, but for actin. So some of the identifiable features that are worth noting at this sarcomere are the Z lines, or sometimes they're called Z discs, which basically are jagged proteins on both ends of the sarcomere. It's also worth mentioning that we have a center anchor within the sarcomere, and that's known as the M line. And if you look at these different bands and zones down here, notice that right here in the middle, where there only seems to be myosin present, we would call that area of the sarcomere the H zone. And on the ends, where there only seems to be actin present, we would call that I bands. And note that there is a third area, this A band here that's in red. The A band always spans the length of myosin. So what you can see here is that there is some actin and myosin overlap within the area of the A band. Now, one of your ninja points to ponder is, how would some of these identifiable features of the sarcomere change their size or appearance during sarcomere shortening or sarcomere lengthening? Let's conceptualize that a little bit. When actin and myosin stick together and actin's dragged along myosin, that means that since actin's connected to these Z lines, the Z lines are going to come towards the center. And the overlap between actin and myosin is going to become greater. If the H zone, by definition, is just the area where myosin is present, as these actins encroach on that, the H zone gets smaller. And if the I band inherently is the space where only actin resides, well, you can imagine then that as these Z lines get closer to the center, the I bands also get smaller. Importantly, remember that the A band always spans the length of myosin. And myosin is not actually getting longer or shorter during sarcomere shortening, nor is actin getting longer or shorter. They're static lengths, which means that if the A band is the length of myosin, it's going to stay constant during sarcomere shortening or lengthening. All right, so you bundle a bunch of myofibrils and all of those end-to-end sarcomeres together, and what you have here is a muscle fiber or cell. I'll sometimes use those terms interchangeably, but they're basically the same thing. So there's a variety of structures that are distinct at the muscle fiber level. I'm not going to go into depth on a lot of those, but I do want to just point out a few. So as a reminder, since muscle fiber is a cell, that means it's going to have some of the normal cell things. So it's going to have an outside plasma membrane that we call the sarcolemma. On the inside, there's going to be some goo. That's the pink stuff here, and we're going to call that the sarcoplasm. And within that sarcoplasm, we can store a bunch of different things like fuel sources, creatine phosphate, carbohydrates, fats, and so on. We'll get more into that in metabolism. Remember that skeletal muscle is unique in that it's multinucleated, so there's lots of nuclei here to direct the operations of the cell. And there's also multiple mitochondria throughout the cell. Another notable feature is the transverse tubules, or T-tubules, that allow an action potential to run from the outside of that sarcolemma inward in order to reach the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Now, the sarcoplasmic reticulum is sort of this spider web illustrated here in brown. And the sarcoplasmic reticulum is where we store calcium within a muscle fiber. And that calcium is ultimately going to be released to initiate skeletal muscle contraction. Now, just adjacent on both sides of these T-tubules are enlarged portions of the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and those are known as terminal cisterna. And because they're enlarged portions of the SR, there tends to be a lot more calcium in these particular areas. Something else that's notable are these things known as satellite cells. Now, I have illustrated them in blue. That's not to be confused with the mitochondria here. Just ran out of colors. But satellite cells essentially lie dormant on the outside of a muscle fiber's sarcolemma, but they're stuck there by the connective tissue that surrounds the sarcolemma. We call that endomysium. Now, these satellite cells play a very important role as it relates to skeletal muscle growth and repair. All right, now listen up. At the muscle fiber level, it's probably worth mentioning something known as dystrophin. Now, dystrophin is a protein that would typically extend from the muscle fiber through the sarcolemma outward into what we call the extracellular matrix. Now, that's basically all the stuff outside and around muscle fibers. By having a lot of dystrophin proteins linking muscle fibers together, it adds an additional amount of rigidity to muscle tissue itself. Now, for those folks that have muscular dystrophy, there's a few different types of that. They either don't produce any dystrophin or they produce it abnormally. But the cumulative effect is the same. If you don't have dystrophin or it just isn't working correctly, there's less structural rigidity to the muscle. And that means that skeletal muscle can be damaged more easily, often by tasks that most people take for granted. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that someone with muscular dystrophy can't enjoy an active lifestyle. Doesn't mean that they can't perform resistance training. But the clinical exercise physiologist should be conservative with the exercise prescription. To that point, Mikhail Melamed, a Venezuelan man, became the first person with muscular dystrophy to complete the Boston Marathon back in 2015. Typically, individuals with muscular dystrophy, for the reasons I've mentioned, have difficulty accomplishing tasks such as walking and running, yet he was able to prove that it's still possible, which is pretty impressive given that a marathon is already difficult enough. Myostatin as a protein is produced and secreted by the muscle fibers, and then it acts on specific targets within that muscle fiber to negatively regulate its growth. Now, what do I mean by negatively regulate? What I mean is that myostatin acts to contain the size or cross-sectional area of a muscle fiber. If you have less myostatin produced and secreted from a muscle fiber, well, as you probably guessed it, that means those muscle fibers or cells could get even larger. Now, geneticists have known about myostatin for quite some time. And the genes that would affect how much myostatin your body produces are often manipulated in animals. This has been shown in bulls that are what we call double-muscled and whippets, which are typically very slim race dogs. But when you block the myostatin genes, you can see here that they look quite a bit different. Some humans either have a complete or more commonly partial blockage of myostatin. And very commonly, those particular humans are extraordinarily strong, such as Eddie Hall, who is a world record holding powerlifter and world strongest man competitor. Back in grad school at the University of Idaho, I met a thrower by the name of J.B. Olsen, who hailed from Denmark. And even at that time, while he was throwing for Idaho, he was a world-class shot putter hailing from Denmark. He competed in multiple world championships and Olympics, and later turned to a life of politics for Denmark. It was later found that he had a partial blockage of myostatin, which helps explain his immense size and power capabilities. If you'd like to know more about myostatin, why don't you go ahead and check out the video that I have linked in the description below. Let's spend a little more time talking about the connective tissues that help stitch this all together. And there's three primary levels that we'll speak to in this particular learning mission. There's endomycium, paramycium, and epimycium. Now, endo can be thought of inside, and epi can be thought of as outside, and peri somewhere in the middle. So endomycium is a connective tissue primarily comprised of collagen and elastin. Remember that collagen provides a lot of structural rigidity and strength, whereas elastin provides that elastic quality that we desire in a skeletal muscle. So that endomycium is going to wrap a muscle fiber. This is not to be confused with the sarcolemma that we see as the outside of a muscle fiber. The sarcolemma is a plasma membrane. Endomycium is a connective tissue that would wrap around that sarcolemma. So every individual fiber is wrapped with some endomycium. And when we get up to a bundle of fibers, the fascicle level here, we see that there's an extra amount of connective tissue that keeps them all bundled, and that's this paramycium. And then to keep all those fascicles bundled together, on the outside of our whole muscle, we have epimycium. Now again, all three levels have an abundance of collagen and elastin. So there's a lot of strength, there's a lot of elasticity here. And those properties are woven all the way down to a microscopic level within the skeletal muscle. So that starts to lay a foundation of understanding then when we see even a single muscle fiber contract, a microscopic structure. Even when a single muscle fiber contracts, because it's connected to connective tissue, that's connected to connective tissue, that's connected to connective tissue, this small amount of contraction registers as a measurable amount of force at the whole muscle level. Now let's talk about this idea of muscle architecture. Now that word architecture probably evokes something more along the lines of home design. That's kind of the same idea with muscles as well. They don't all look the same. Even houses that look different often have the same building materials. There's probably some concrete, there's probably wood, there's going to be shingles and nails and so on. And the same is also true for muscles. Even though they may look different, they're built with all of the same things that we've discussed thus far. They have myofilaments and fibrils, and they've got type 2X fibers and type 1 fibers and so on. But that design, the shape of the muscle, evokes certain potential benefits. So when we talk about this idea of muscle architecture, know that there's two broad categories. There's what we would consider to be parallel muscles and those that are pinnate. Now, hallmark of parallel muscles is that along the central line of pull, so this would be basically tendon to tendon, you'll see that the muscle fibers are arranged parallel to that line of pull. Now, in a pinnate muscle, you'll see that the muscle fibers are arranged at an angle to that central line of pull. Now you may be wondering, okay, what gives? What's the potential benefits of that type of an arrangement versus this? Well, with parallel fibers, if you stack them end to end to end to end to end, what that means is when they all shorten, all those sarcomeres shorten, you're going to get a large degree of shortening at the whole muscle level. And if you have a large degree of shortening at the whole muscle level, well, that means that you could impart a large range of motion at a joint. Now, it's also worth mentioning that when you have all of those fibers laid end to end to end to end to end, there is the potential, I stress that word potential, the potential for faster muscle shortening as well. With a pinnate architecture, you may not necessarily realize large or super fast ranges of motion like we would see with parallel muscles. However, this arrangement allows you to jam-pack more muscle fibers into a given space confine. And because of that, pinnate muscles often give rise to larger cross-sectional areas,
or basically the diameter of a fiber, and by extension, the diameter of a muscle, the larger that is, the more potential force it can produce. So by being able to jam-pack in more fibers here, there's the potential for added strength. If that's still not entirely clear to you, picture a tug-of-war contest. Now, typically, in tug-of-war, you've got a rope, and the goal is to be able to pull one team. Let's just say that they're aligned along that rope on each side of the line. Your goal is to pull one team across the line. Now, typically, the most efficient line of pull is for everyone to get up nice and close to that rope so they can then pull straight back. That would be the most effective line of pull. And you would see that. That's basically mirroring what we have here in the parallel muscle. However, let's just say that team A is considerably stronger than team B. So even though both teams are using the most efficient line of pull, team A just keeps winning. So team B decides we need a new strategy. Let's go and call more people over to our side. Now, all of a sudden, as you start to add more people, you start to run into one another, and you'll see that not everyone can get up right next to the rope. Some people are going to have to reach out at an angle to this line of pull so that they can help. So some people will be pulling obliquely to that. But notice that in the same amount of space, we have more people. And you can think of that as more muscle fibers. So if you can cram more fibers into this space, even though each person or fiber isn't necessarily pulling in the most efficient direction, cumulatively, there's a lot of forces that are all pulling this direction, and it's a no-brainer. Team B is going to win that bout of tug-of-war. So coming back to this idea of a pinnate muscle architecture, oftentimes it makes sense to compartmentalize fibers in one area of the body, and if that area is very tight, you want to be able to put as many fibers into that space as you possibly can. A great example would be the gastrocnemius. So the gastrocnemius, I tried to model this after that, has a large muscle belly proximal to the knee. But then it terminates in a very long tendon that goes all the way down to the heel here. Now you might be thinking, why isn't the gastrocnemius shaped like a parallel muscle, like the biceps brachii? Well, the belly of the biceps brachii, the belly of a lot of parallel muscles, is in the center. And what we have seen through study after study after study of human movement efficiency, the more mass you can centrally locate, the easier it is to move. So it tends to be that at our extremities, our hands, and our feet, we don't have a lot of mass. Generally speaking, the muscles are concentrated closer to the joints. They're more proximally located so that we're not whipping around big weights. And you can feel this for yourself. If you were to put on really heavy shoes and go for a run, you would instantly feel how much harder that is. So the idea of the gastrocnemius having most of its mass proximally located to the knee is to decrease a lot of weight at the end of that extremity and make it easier for us to move. So if we have to concentrate all that mass close to the knee, we want to make sure that we get as many fibers in as possible so that we can maximize the force output of that muscle. In summary, parallel muscles have fibers that are in line or parallel to that central tendinous line of pull, whereas pinnate muscles have fibers that are obliquely arranged to that central line of pull. And the potential benefit of the parallel muscles is that you can faster range of motion or a larger range of motion. And on the pinnate side, you can potentially maximize cross-sectional area and force production.
I hope you enjoyed this concept video. Let me know your questions via email or when we can connect. Also, feel free to check out episode 2 of Neuromuscular Phys, where you'll learn more about differences in skeletal muscle fiber types. Take care.